a button on the video control, and it, you know, basically the name of the delegate and it goes directly to the delegate. So it's kind of, you know, the C-SPAN type. You can access these videos on the General Assembly website, and then each committee meeting has a link and subcommittee has a link. You can live stream every committee meeting, meetings are being live streamed by us internally, only committee meetings, but you can live stream every video, but it's only at a 40-second delay due to security reasons. And so yes, we're, you know, very excited, and we enjoy working with y'all and looking forward to the rest of the sessions.
So question, so that is just a camera. So to pick up the sound, you have to have this on.
Yes, sir.
And if you notice, when it's red, it's hot. So, so any questions? All right, so speaking now. Okay, thank you. All right, so before we get started, we have three new members, and so I'd like for y'all to recognize yourself and why you want to be on this committee.
Hi, I'm Deborah Rodman. I'm from the 73rd District, Central and Western Henrico. I'm really excited to be on this committee. I'm an anthropologist. I've spent years working with farmers in Guatemala. My grandpa was grew up on a farm. So I'm, and of course I have a master's degree in marine affairs and policy. So for me, this is close to my heart.
Hi there, my name is Wendy Vidaitis, and I'm from House District 10, which is Leesburg and parts of Loudoun, Clark, and Frederick counties. I'm a lifelong horsewoman, have lived in the country all my life. I live one farm away from the Shenandoah River, which we want to keep beautiful. So there are lots of things going on here that align with my experiences.
Good morning. My name is Dawn Adams. I am representing the District 68. It is Richmond, Northern Chesterfield, and Henrico. I'm excited to be on this committee. I grew up in the Coast Guard, so the ocean is important to me. The James River is where it flows through my district. I have family in Tidewater. I'm an animal lover, and I think that agriculture is an important and necessary business that we have to take care of.
Well, thank you all. So, and if you have any questions, you know, about the committee, please let us know. We want you to be, you know, successful. So first in the batter's box today is we're going to have Bernard Green, who's appointed by the Governor of Northern as the Secretary of Agriculture and Forestry. So welcome. Please come forward.
Good morning. Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. It's a delight to be with you today, serving as your new Secretary of Agriculture and Forestry. As many of you know, I previously served as the state forester with the Virginia Department of Forestry, and that's where I began my career. I'm very excited about serving in this new capacity, honored and humbled by the opportunity, and look forward to working with all of you to advance agriculture and forestry. I started my career with the department many years ago as a young forester in the field, and then moved up within the organization with West for a while, and then came back home. So it's great to be back home, and I can tell you that I've been passionate about agriculture and forestry from a very, very young age. So look forward to doing all that we can to make sure that we have even more sustainable resources moving forward. And we have a good team within the Secretariat, and I have the pleasure of introducing to you some new folks this morning that will be doing the presentation today. I'd like to introduce the new State Forester, Rob Farrell.
Good morning.
And Rob has been with the organization, the Department of Forestry, for 18 years, was serving as Deputy State Forester for the past 6 years. We also have an acting Ag Commissioner, many of you know well, who was the Deputy Ag Commissioner and is now serving in an interim capacity until we fill that position, and that's Charles Green, who's with us.
Good morning.
You have asked that we give an update today on industrial hemp, which Charles is going to be doing, and also an opportunity for us to provide you the latest study, just the highlights from the latest agricultural and forestry study. And so both Charles and Rob are going to be doing this presentation and getting into more of the details of that. So I'm going to turn things over to them at this point.
Let's see if we have any questions. If anybody has any questions on your screen up there, it's a request to speak, so just push the button. We'll see you now. Thank you,
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
again with the Virginia Department of Agriculture and Consumer Services. I appreciate the opportunity to be before you today to talk about two interesting topics. The first is industrial hemp, and the second is the economic impact of agriculture and forestry in the Commonwealth of Virginia. As many of you may know, hemp refers to the non-psychoactive varieties of the plant Cannabis sativa. Both hemp and marijuana come from that same plant species, which is cannabis, but are genetically distinct and can be distinguished by their chemical makeup, that is, by their THC content. Cannabis, which includes both hemp and marijuana, remain classified as Schedule I substances under the Federal Controlled Substances Act. However, the 2014 Farm Bill does authorize institutions of higher education or state departments of agriculture to grow hemp for research under agricultural pilot projects or for academic research programs when a state has passed a law that allows this, as Virginia has done. The Farm Bill defines industrial hemp to be any part of that plant, Cannabis sativa, whether or not growing with a THC content not to exceed 0.3% on a dry weight basis. So in summary, the full commercial production, which I think was a question that some of the committee members had, the full commercial production of industrial hemp is either contingent upon the federal law changing further or on Virginia taking action that disregards federal law. I would like to mention that currently there is H.R. 3530, also called the Industrial Hemp Farming Act of 2017, that is in Congress now. His 39 co-sponsors, among those are Virginia's Congressmen Goodlatte, Griffith, Garrett, and Bratt. And this would amend the Federal Controlled Substances Act to exclude industrial hemp from the definition of marijuana. Additionally, H.R. 3530 requires that the production, storage, distribution, and use of industrial hemp be lawful in the state which those activities are conducted. And it also requires, as written now, that upon request of the U.S. Attorney General's office, that a state would release certain information, including the name of growers and also the GPS coordinates in specifying the location of authorized hemp fields. As you all know, that in response to the Farm Bill language several years ago, the 2015 General Assembly session passed the Virginia Industrial Hemp Farming Law, which authorizes the Commissioner of Agriculture and Consumer Services to establish and oversee industrial hemp research programs that are directly managed by institutions, public institutions of higher education. In the two growing seasons since being introduced, we've entered into agreements with Virginia Tech, Virginia State University, James Madison, and the University of Virginia to conduct research. Some of the universities have partnered with private growers, farmers, to conduct research, while others have limited their research to on-farm activities on university and properties. We do expect, however, in 2018 growing season, all of the universities will work with private growers in some respect. As you see from the slide, nationally, the majority of states have enacted some type of hemp law or program, and the states are managing these in a variety of ways. Some of them are managed in strict compliance with the Farm Bill language, but there are several others that regulate and license commercial hemp production outside of the Farm Bill allowance. Fast forwarding to today, based on 2 years of successfully working with universities and recognizing stakeholders in the farming community wanted to expand Virginia's program further to allow for us to take full advantage of all of the provisions allowed under the 2014 Farm Bill, our department worked with Senator Dance and others, including industrial hemp supporters, agricultural organizations and associations, the Department of Forensic Science, and other law enforcement entities to come up with a legislative proposal that expands the opportunity for the production of hemp by adding a research component that's directly managed by our Department of Agriculture. So the result of that is Senator Dance's bill, SB 247, which allows farmers and processors to grow industrial hemp without participating in a program that's managed by a university. This proposal replaces the current industrial hemp growers license with a much more simple registration process for growers. The bill also eliminates the current burdensome requirement that applicants include a fingerprint-based criminal history check along with their application. This was the number one complaint we heard from the universities and from the farmers, especially those dealing with grad students and things in the summer where they've only got somebody for a limited window of time. Doing those background checks took a long period of time, and the growing season was half done by the time we could clear them and get some of those individuals licensed. As you also know, there are several other hemp bills being considered by the General Assembly this session. However, we feel that SB 247 is the most efficient at preparing Virginia to respond immediately to any changes in federal law regarding industrial hemp, as it allows for the adoption of regulations if that is a requirement set forth in federal law, but it does not mandate registration or other regulatory requirements if the federal law eventually changes and treats hemp just like any other agricultural commodity. SB 247 would again amend the industrial hemp law to allow us to address many of the concerns that we have heard from stakeholders and farmers, allowing them to take full advantage of the opportunities offered under the Farm Bill, and would do so with a minimal fiscal impact. So now we're switching gears from industrial hemp, and I don't know if it's the chairman's desire to take questions on industrial hemp or go through the entire presentation.
Let's see, any questions on hemp? Push your button. All learning here today, or you just raise your hand. Okay. Yeah, Tony.
Mr. Chairman, so the changes that are proposed in, I think it was 247, has that been run by state police? I mean, we're okay, we're not letting down any of our safeguards as far as the use of.
We had stakeholder meetings over the summer, I think in June or July. State police was present at those meetings, and other law enforcement representatives. We've also shared with them throughout the process copies of different versions of the bill, different revisions and changes to the bill along the process. So I think my feeling is that law enforcement has had ample time to look at the bills and the provisions and express their interest in certain sections or not.
Any further questions on? Okay, thank you.
So switching gears now, I want to talk about something else that is very exciting, and that is the economic impact study that was released earlier in 2017 regarding Virginia's agriculture and forest industries. And as many of you all may have seen, the study determined that the annual economic impact of agriculture and forest-related industries in Virginia was over $91 billion, a significant increase from the previous study, which was released in 2013. Also, the total employment impact of these sectors combined was an impressive 442,000 jobs, which includes the primary production, pork processing, extended processing, and distribution. And if you broke it down even further, about 76% of the jobs are tied to the agriculture sector, and 24% are related to forestry. The economic benefits of Virginia's agricultural and forest products industries are further enhanced by the finding that every dollar in production generated creates $1.15 in value-added impact to Virginia's economy as well. The benefits of these industries extend to employment supported in other sectors of the economy as well, with every job in ag and forestry supporting 1.7 jobs elsewhere in the economy. Even by itself, when you just look at agriculture and primary agricultural production, which would mean basically the farming, tilling of fields and tending to animals, that directly employs almost 54,000 people across the Commonwealth. And adding on top of that, the core value-added production in agriculture alone employs more at 69,000 workers. One of the reasons for the economic vitality of Virginia's agriculture industry is the wide diversity of products found across the Commonwealth. Regional differences in geography, soil type, and weather patterns mean that Virginia has one of the most diverse agricultural portfolios in the nation, as demonstrated by this chart here. And here's a list of our top agricultural commodities in Virginia, and while the value of the farm cash receipts from these commodities is certainly impressive, it's also notable that many commodities, and some that are not even listed in our top commodities, do rank in the top 10 in the nation and rank us in the top 10 among all U.S. states. And these include leaf tobacco, apples, wine grapes, peanuts, broilers, fresh market tomatoes, and cotton.
Good morning again, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. Just to perspective, in the top commodities list, forestry would come in just a little above milk, at about $335 million paid to landowners for the stumpage. Agriculture and forestry, again, one of the benefits in Virginia is we can conduct forestry and agriculture in just about every part of Virginia. Largest clusters of industry for agriculture are the Shenandoah Valley, Northern Virginia, and Central Virginia. Forestry, primarily most of our value from forestry is in pine plantations, so most of that is in the southern and eastern southern part of Virginia. A lot of our employment is also located where we have mills. Top agriculture producing communities centered around where we have pasture and poultry. The forestry communities, again, southern eastern Virginia, where most of our pine production is located. We have a great story in forestry. Since the recession, forestry values in both volume of forestry that forest products that we're producing, as well as value coming to the state, are both on an increase, and both saw records since we have been keeping records. The highest levels we've reported were in 2016. 2016 was slightly down for stumpage paid to landowners, but it was a record in 2015 as well. Just to kind of show that trend, again, since the recession, 2000-2008, when things kind of bottomed out, production has been increasing. The blue line is what we get from pine, and the orange line is what we get from hardwood. Hardwood declined last year, mostly because of the strong dollar and a decrease in imports in China. So, but again, overall, a trend of increasing value for Virginia. Also, just to mention, one of Virginia's primary means of increasing production of agriculture and forestry is the AFID program, Agriculture and Forestry Industry Development Fund. A great deal of success. These fund both business expansion as well as local community planning. You can see the $400 million in new investment plus close to $400 million in additional products grown. These expansion have to include at least 30% Virginia-grown products. Beyond the direct economic impact and employment of agriculture and forestry, having working lands on the landscape provide great many other benefits: recreation, tourism, environmental benefits. You can see agritourism, they've accounted for $2.2 billion in economic activity. The wine industry alone, $1.4 billion. The air quality and water quality benefits have been quantified for forest and agricultural land. Forests in Virginia provide $6.7 billion a year in benefits through air and water quality. Where a lot of our products are going overseas, the top 10 countries are listed there. $2.7 billion in 2016 in international exports. Again, the exports contribute a great deal to the economy, $9 billion in total output, 46,000 jobs, $4.6 billion in value added. So 10% of that agriculture and forestry economic impact is related to exports. One in nine Virginia forest or farming jobs is related to exports. That breakdown of $9 billion in output, it's about a little less than one-third forestry, two-thirds agriculture. Thank you. Happy to address any questions.
Let's see, do we have any questions? Somebody push your request to speak. Oh, look, it's working. All right, now it's ours.
Mr. Chairman, what year was that slide that you were showing us of the counties where the most timber production came from?
That was fiscal year 2016.
Follow-up question. Can we get a copy of that? And is there any way or has any studies been done to affect the value of timber in localities where there's a market for the waste chips or active borers?
Absolutely. The forest products tax, now we have included the category for biomass. So beginning in fiscal year 2016, we have that information as well.
Mr. Chairman, could I get a copy of that?
Absolutely.
All right, Dr. Evans.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question about the RT funding. Can you let us talk to us a minute about the benefits of that?
Absolutely. The reforestation of timberlands program is based on a tax that was voluntarily developed by the forest industry, the forest products tax. So all forest products tax, or forest products at the first point of manufacturing pays a tax. The Department of Forestry uses those funds partially for protection of the forest through our firefighting efforts, and then also to assist landowners in reforestation of their lands after timber harvesting. And so we're very excited that the General Assembly provided us full funding of RT. It's the RT tax is matched by funding from the General Assembly, and last year we got full match, and all of that money was provided to the landowners, and the demand, of course, exceeds the available funds every year.
Dr. Will.
Mr. Chairman, what's the forestry Department of Forestry's outlook on the ash situation? And Mr. Chairman, if that gets too long, perhaps it might be an issue that we could see a presentation at another time, but it's very critical.
Unfortunately, the prognosis for ash in Virginia is much like the American chestnut. It will be wiped out from the forest landscape en masse. We have a program where we are trying to save individual ash trees throughout the state that we hope will then provide a reservoir of ash seed and genetics after we hopefully find some way to slow the spread of the ash, emerald ash borer. So at this point, it looks like it will be lost from the forest at a large scale for the time being.
Yes, my questions are regarding the RT tax dollars. We spend some of that on firefighting, and we also spend it on landowner reseed. Can you give me some feel for the proportion of how much goes to reseeding versus other purposes?
Thank you, Tim.
It's a very small percentage, and it's actually the percentage tax that comes from most of the hardwood tax that comes into the program that goes back into fire suppression. A very small percentage, so I think I can give you those exact figures, but most all of the money is going right back out the door to go on the ground for reforestation and other forestry practices. And we will get those exact figures to you, but it's less than 10%.
Thank you, ma'am. Sorry.
Okay, seeing no further questions while you're in the batter's box, request to give us a little bit of background on yourself and how you got here.
Right. How much time do you have?
30 seconds.
Great. So I grew up in rural Virginia, in Craig County, near Roanoke, Virginia. For those of you that may not be familiar with Craig, we still have no stoplights in my home county, but we're proud of that, and about a population of 5,000. Grew up next door to my grandparents, fell in love with trees and gardening and farming, and the rest is really history. Had a good opportunity to study forestry at Virginia Tech, go Hokies, and then to come on board with the Department of Forestry as a field forester. Moved to our headquarters office to manage the Urban and Community Forestry Program, so working with urban communities and small towns across the state of the Commonwealth, a program that's been in place for quite some time now that's been very effective. And then went back to my home region, to the central region where I got my start as regional forester when Jim Garner was state forester. I was then selected as the deputy state forester and worked hand in hand with Jim Garner for 6 years before moving west and exploring the nonprofit world in land conservation in Colorado, in Northern California. Had the good opportunity to come back home when you know it's time to come home, back in 2012, overseeing the American Tree Farm Program, working in Washington, D.C. and nationally, and then was appointed as state forester under Governor McCullough 4 years ago.
Okay.
So that's it in a nutshell. And thank you for the opportunity to share. We're happy to visit with any of you and talk in more detail about that, but I want to be respectful of your time. And I also want to recognize and introduce to you another member of our team who's with us today. I shared with you those that bring the state experience to the table, but we're fortunate to also have Deputy Secretary of Agriculture and Forestry, Stacy Brayboy, with us.
Good morning.
Stacy comes to us from the USDA. Stacy served for 8 years as the Chief of Staff for the CFO at the USDA. And considering the fact that the Farm Bill program is extremely important to the state of Virginia, we're working now to put together a new Farm Bill that's going to help forestry and agriculture, and the relationships and partnerships that Stacy has been engaged with is really going to make a difference for us to be able to move forward with things that are important here in the Commonwealth. So I'm really happy to have Stacy as part of our team and look forward to working with her. We are both here and available to answer any questions you have throughout the session and beyond. But thank you for this opportunity. And just to give you a quick another background on Stacy, she also comes from a rural community in South Carolina. Lives in Virginia, but her roots are in rural Virginia or South Carolina as well.
Okay. Any questions? All right. Seeing none. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I have a question for you.
Sure.
You talk a lot about your forestry background, and we're aware of that.
Yes.
Good work that you've done as a state forester. But now you have a broader responsibility, an agricultural responsibility as well. I wonder if you could say a couple of words as to how you view blending those responsibilities.
Yeah, thank you. That's very important. And I do recognize that agriculture is number one for the economy in the state. Certainly combined, we're number one, forestry being number three behind tourism. I have, I grew up gardening and farming with my family in Craig County. I've always loved agriculture. I really cared and became even more passionate about that as I was working in the field, but when I was in Northern California, where agriculture is huge there as well. And we want to continue to try to get as close to California, not as it relates to regulations and other things necessarily, but certainly the passion for agriculture and food here in the state. And I told Sandy Adams this recently, I had to catch myself and kind of stay in my lane as state forester, because I would see Sandy doing all these exciting things around agriculture and food and local food and all of the work that we do here in the state. And so I wanted to support her and not step into that, step on her toes, but I am happy now to have both of those have that responsibility. We're going to do everything we can to continue to advance the previous work that has been done by the secretaries, and Secretary Haymore, as you know, did so much to advance agriculture in the state as well as forestry, international as well as domestic marketing and promotion of our products. Many things I want to share with you about my vision. We will do that later about where we're headed and where Governor Northam wants to go. But I think there are real opportunities to bring ag and forestry together to deal with succession planning, the future, making sure that we retain farmland and forest land in the state, making sure tools are in the toolbox for farmers. And so I'm quite passionate about agriculture and look forward to spending more time with our stakeholders. I work closely with them now, but getting out in the field to learn everything that I don't know about agriculture, and so make sure that I'm continuing to represent the state as best as I can.
Okay, thank you. Paula?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, if I could, the other challenge you're going to face is this urbanization and suburbanization of Virginia. We recognize the importance of agriculture and forestry, but how do you see that rapid urbanization of Virginia affecting what you're doing, and what are you going to do to help our, for example, suburban community in which I live continue to have forest cover?
Right. Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Members, I think it's an opportunity. That's the way I like to look at it. We know that we have an urban population in the state. We want to serve all people in the Commonwealth, and that we have a spectrum of services that we provide in forestry and agriculture that ranges from very rural economic development to making sure that urban customers have the best food, that we have food security, that we also make sure that we have strong natural resources across the state, and that we have we make that link with public health, the connection between forestry and agriculture and our urban populations. And I think there's so many opportunities around urban ag, but also looking at making sure that we do all that we can to address conversion of farmland and forest land. And there are a number of tools in the toolbox for that. Keeping it voluntary, making sure that landowners can access conservation easements if they need to. And for example, we have over 168 working forestry easements with the Department of Forestry. VDACS works very closely with local government as it relates to ag preservation, So there are tools in the toolbox to make sure that we keep land privately owned, that farmers and forest landowners continue to actively manage their lands, but that we keep a bit from being converted, where it shouldn't be, to development, knowing that we want to continue to promote growth in the state where that's appropriate. So I think it is that balance, and it's certainly one thing that Governor Northam made very clear to me is his desire to make sure that we're balancing economic development with environmental protection, and we're big believers that we can do that and do it well, and private land stewardship is a very important part of that, and look forward to exploring that more with you.
Okay. Other questions?
Mr. Chairman, I have a motion.
You have a motion. I'd like to hear it.
Mr. Chairman, as part of the approval process for the Secretary, it's the committees of specialty are asked to make a recommendation, and I move that we recommend that Bettina Ring be confirmed for a position of Secretary of Agriculture and Forestry.
All right, have a second.
Second.
Discussion. Hearing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Congratulations. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Don't be a stranger.
Always here whenever you need me. Thank you for the opportunity.
All right, so next we have Matt Strickler, and Matt is appointed by the Governor of Northern as Secretary of Natural Resources, and Mr. Strickler, welcome.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Chair Marshall, members of the committee, thank you for having me this morning. I don't have a big presentation or anything. I know Mr. Paler is going to present you all on the Bill of Lading settlement, and that will be more substantive than anything I have to say today. I just wanted to come down and take the opportunity to introduce myself as Governor Northam's nominee for Secretary of Natural Resources. I've had the opportunity to come by and meet with a number of you since session started. Appreciate your time, and those of you I haven't had a chance to see yet, I'm working hard to get on your calendar, so we'll set that up shortly. By way of background, I'm a lifelong Virginian. I grew up in Lexington and in Rockbridge County. Have a background in marine science and in public policy. Got a graduate degree from Virginia Institute of Marine Science. Also have some experience working for the governor as a legislative aide in the state senate when he was on the. Working in the Capitol, and more recently have been working on Capitol Hill on the Natural Resources Committee, handling a portfolio of issues, including fisheries, oceans, wildlife, and some public lands and energy issues. So that's kind of generally what I'm about. Really looking forward to the opportunity to work with all of you all on advancing Governor Northam's priorities, and of course yours as well. I have a lot to learn from all of you, especially since I've been out of state. State policy for 5 or 6 years about what we need to do to continue to make sure that we're getting good value from Virginia's natural resources and also doing a good job of being stewards of the environment. So thank you again for having me. I'm happy to answer any questions you have.
So anyone have any questions? Hearing none. Yes.
Yeah, I wonder if it might be appropriate since again there's an expectation that we make a recommendation. Confirmation. Can you fill in a little more detail about the specific backgrounds that lead to this kind of position?
Sure, happy to. So, my personal background, my personal involvement in natural resources and the outdoors started when I was very young. I was, as I mentioned, born and raised in Lexington and Rockbridge County, and actually grew up in Natural Bridge when I was very young. So, spent a lot of time. A lot of time outdoors. My family's from Virginia Beach and had a place over on the Eastern Shore, which we're still fortunate enough to have. So at an early age, I was exposed to the Chesapeake Bay and the Atlantic Ocean and was very interested in fisheries and oceans. So that's kind of where I took my studies academically and at FIMS. I worked on coastal management issues, aquaculture issues, trying to figure out the kind of the link between a clean environment and economically important development of aquaculture and shellfish industry and in general. My time working for Senator Northam, I had the privilege of being able to staff him on the Agriculture Committee when he was a member of that committee in the Senate. So work with him on a whole suite of issues relating not only to natural resources and the Chesapeake Bay, but agriculture and forestry as well. And most recently my work in Washington, D.C., advising congressional Democrats on natural resources issues. I've had the opportunity to, you know, to get involved with federal fisheries management, including some of the fisheries that you know, the folks in Virginia, you know, are going after, and you know, have gotten exposure to, you know, to looking at wildlife issues, environmental regulation, you know, all the kind of things that are within the purview of this secretariat. So I know it's a big responsibility, but I think I've got the right background to at least you know, get up to speed quickly and help you know, help Governor Northam run the Commonwealth well.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I guess my question, Matt, is
not the speaker.
I guess my question goes to the national scene with Atlantic States Marine Fisheries. I think New Jersey has ignored, if I'm not mistaken, and you probably can fill me in better on that because I'm not in that industry. But if they are allowed to ignore Atlantic States Marine Fisheries, how do you see Virginia responding to that?
Yes, sir. Thank you for the question. This is something that I worked directly on.
Sir, paint a picture, because some of the people here, you know, don't make their living.
Happy to give some background.
So we might want to give a little bit of background first.
Yes, sir. So the just to back up, the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission is a regional commission. All of the states from Maine to Florida participate in this, and they're responsible for managing fisheries that are migratory, that are shared among the various states. So one of the examples of a fishery like that is summer flounder, which is what the delegate is alluding to. Summer flounder is a very important commercial and recreational fishery in Virginia, as it is in other states. The Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission, all of the states get together and set, you know, rules, harvest numbers, and allocations among the states for these various fisheries. Recently, the state of New Jersey decided to not abide by the recommendation of the Atlantic States Marine Fisheries Commission and do what we call going out of compliance. So they decided that they wanted their harvest quota for summer flounder to be higher than was recommended by the commission and agreed to by the other states. The commission was certainly opposed to that action. Unfortunately, the administration in Washington, D.C., signed off on that action, which is troubling because these kinds of cooperative agreements don't work unless everybody cooperates. So, you know, from my perspective, I want Virginia to be a good partner in the Atlantic States Commission and other regional bodies that we participate in on natural resources. Going out of compliance is something that that I see as not sound public policy. We have concerns about something the commission's doing. We should work through the commission process and voice our concerns that way rather than trying to go outside of it.
Yes, Doug Vogel.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. You've got an exciting 4 years ahead of you. And I didn't want to get into the weeds about some of the big issues that I know you're facing. We've got coal ash, we've got pipelines, we've got Chesapeake Bay restoration and deadlines coming up with that. But I was interested in hearing a little bit more about kind of your philosophy about how you work through those issues and how you intend to kind of organize your staff you know, to make sure the stakeholders have a voice going through the process. But give us a little idea about, you know, how you want to tackle those issues from a systemic way, you know, without getting into the weeds on you know, what the administration, how they feel about those issues.
Yes, sir. Thank you for the question, Delegate. You know, in general, I think you know, these big picture issues like Chesapeake Bay restoration, we're not going to make any progress unless we are collaborative and transparent and are bringing all the stakeholders to the table. You know, you've seen that in the past with you know, some of the progress we've made over the last few years on issues like stormwater, on issues like you know, agricultural best management practices, and of course the great progress we've made on reducing you know, pollutants from point sources across the Commonwealth. You know, interstate bodies are challenging to deal with, and we want to make sure that we're engaged. I personally will be working on issues doing just the Bay Commission that you know, try to push good policies forward in a regional setting. Russ Baxter, who's currently the Deputy Secretary for Chesapeake Bay, has done a wonderful job in that capacity for Governor McAuliffe. Ann Jennings, the incoming Deputy Secretary for the Chesapeake Bay, is going to be working directly with you and other members of the commission on those issues. So it's something that the Chesapeake Bay in particular and other big picture issues in general, like coal ash, as you mentioned, are the things we want to take a collaborative approach on with members of the conservation community, business stakeholders, and members of the General Assembly.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A follow-up question, because I know a lot of the focus today with the presentations have been on agriculture and forestry. Those are extraordinarily important components of our economy, and they do deserve a great deal of focus. But coming from a relatively urban, suburban jurisdiction, I'd be remiss if I didn't kind of ask for your perspective on urban stormwater management, particularly with regard to the Chesapeake Bay. One of the things that I noticed was lacking in the governor's budget was any money for the Stormwater Local Assistance Fund grant program. And so just wanted to ask for your feedback or your positions on where does urban stormwater management kind of fit into the grand scheme of what your priorities might be.
Yes, sir. Thank you. You and I had a good conversation yesterday about this, and I appreciated your time. We are very supportive of increased funding for the Stormwater Local Assistance Fund. The outgoing governor chose not to include any funding for that in his introduced budget. We're looking forward to working with you and other members to hopefully get some funding in there. Urban stormwater, as you and I'm sure other members of the committee know, is a huge challenge. We have a lot of old infrastructure in Virginia. It's a very old state with some very old cities. And doing retrofits in that kind of a cluster urban environment is challenging, but it's necessary work and important work. So we want to make sure that we're getting good value on the projects we undertake in Chesapeake Bay cleanup, ranking potential stormwater improvements on the kind of return we're going to get on our investment. But at the same time, we can't ignore those problems because they are significant.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Doug,
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome back. I have a couple of questions. First. Maybe if you could give the committee some information on perhaps your background, interests, thoughts on the TMDLs, the stormwater districts, the best management practices, where you sort of want to go with that, number one. And number two, there's a pretty strong issue between moving inland with the inland lakes, such as Smith Mountain Lake and Clater and so forth, on federal control of those lakes down to what I would call actually zoning and control from the federal average viewpoint. If you've been into that, especially in your Washington tours, if you'd like to comment on where you think that situation might go, because we are facing some significant lawsuits.
Yes, sir. Thank you for the question. Let me do these in reverse order because the second of these is one that I'm not particularly familiar with, but look forward to learning more from you about, and hopefully in the near future we can find some time to sit down and you can get me smart on those issues. On the first issue on the Bay TMDL, the Chesapeake Bay program is certainly a federal state partnership. Our partners at the EPA run a lot of the process there. My viewpoint on this and Governor Northam's viewpoint on this is we want to be in a position where Virginia is creating Virginia solutions to these water quality problems. They are significant, but we don't want to put ourselves in a position where we have the EPA telling us what to do. That's why we're trying to be proactive and make sure that we're hitting our TMDL targets in a way that is reducing pollution and in a manner that is as Bettina said, balancing the importance of economic development with the importance of a clean environment. Okay.
Doug,
Mr. Chairman, I had a question.
Margaret, push your button.
Chairman, I had a couple of questions for Mr. Strickler. As you know, Matt, I know your passion is in aquaculture, and the Commonwealth really has become a leader in the nation, whether it's with the innovation of aquaculture, whether it's oyster, fish, but there's also become a lot of user conflicts. How do you see the administration supporting aquaculture from
You know, as you mentioned, aquaculture is a real Virginia success story, particularly on the shellfish side. We've made a lot of great progress. You know, I have a little bit of experience in the industry, and it's something that I and the governor care a lot about, making sure we advance as an economic development and also as an environmental priority. The user conflict issue is a challenging one. It's one actually that I did a lot of work on when I was at VIMS, trying to figure out how we deal with use conflicts in the coastal zone in general, and between shorefront property owners and shellfish growers in particular. I think this is one where we need to have better communication. I think we need to make sure that we're clear with coastal communities and property owners about the importance of the aquaculture industry as an economic driver, about the water quality benefits, and find a balance that works for everyone on that front. So it's something that I'm going to be personally involved with going forward, and I look forward to working with you on that as well.
Dr. Plum, Mr. Chairman, I have a motion. Okay. Mr. Chairman, I move that Matt Strickler be recommended for confirmation as Secretary of Natural Resources. Do we have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No? Congratulations.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you for being here. Okay, so next we're going to have David Taylor, is Director of the Department of Environmental Quality. David's going to talk to us a little bit about the Volkswagen settlement, an article that I saw in the newspaper. And so he's going to tell us how he ended up with the settlement and how much money we're talking about, where's the money going to, et cetera, et cetera. Thank you, David.
Thanks for being here. Thank you. It's a pleasure, Mr. Chairman. Members of the committee, it's good to be here with you. It's nice to be talking about money that we have rather than money that we don't have. The US EPA and the California Air Board filed a complaint against Volkswagen Corporation and its subsidiaries. It turns out that Volkswagen had put some software into their number of their vehicles that made it look like they were complying with air. Air pollution laws, and they in fact were not, and it defeated the NOx, the nitrogen oxide pollutant emissions, and NOx, we call it NOx, is a precursor to ozone. This involved a little bit over a half a million vehicles, 508,000 vehicles, in for model years 09 to 16, and there are 2 and 3 liter. Diesel engines, and there were a number of settlements that came out of this. $10 billion was used to buy back the offending vehicles. I believe that if you owned one of those vehicles, Volkswagen agreed to buy it back from you. They may have agreed to repair it, but I think most people they bought back. But $10 billion for that. $2 billion for a zero-emission vehicle infrastructure that's run by an organization called Electrify America, and that basically aims to advance the sale of zero-emission vehicles and also recharge stations for that. $1.45 billion is a civil penalty and injunctive relief. $2.9 billion for the Environmental Mitigation Fund, which is the thing that we'll mostly be talking about here. So that $2.9 billion was to mitigate the impact of the higher emissions and to create some improved air quality. States, tribes, Puerto Rico, District of Columbia have been allocated a portion of that. We have to file as beneficiaries with a trustee. The trustee is named by the court, and it's Wilmington Trust that was appointed as the trustee last fall. The trust funds can be spent on 10 different categories of eligible projects, which I'll go over in a minute. Both government and non-government entities can are eligible to apply for trust funds. The beneficiaries beneficiaries are required to develop a mitigation plan that provides a high-level summary of how they intend to allocate their funds, and we have to submit the mitigation plan in advance of requesting funding from the trustee. So in Virginia, there were a little over 16,000 vehicles that lied on their computers tests, and that results in not quite $94 million allocation to Virginia. DEQ is the lead agency and will administer these funds through the state mitigation plan. The Secretary of Natural Resources, Secretary Ward, formed a working group to develop a mitigation plan, and we filed as a beneficiary last November. Our proposed mitigation plan, we use the term data-driven approach. Essentially, the mitigation plan is aimed at getting the best air quality result that we can from the projects that that get funded. The proposed mitigation plan allows for the selection of projects in 10 categories, with about up to 15% going to electric vehicle charging infrastructure. The agency conducted a public comment period last fall. We also issued a request for information, seeking ideas for projects that would fall under one of these 10 categories. And we got 39 proposals. They totaled a little bit more than the money that we have available. They totaled about $596 million. And the proposed mitigation plan and the RFI are available at the website that you see up there. It's on our agency website under Programs in the Air. You can find it pretty easily. And we do continue to receive comments, and our plan has not been finalized. Just for our interest, in terms of the data-driven piece of it, you can see the NOTS emitters that we deal with on-road diesel is 28%. On-road non-diesel light duty is another 40%. So you can see there a breakdown of the different categories of mobile NOTS emitters. So the 10 eligible categories, the first six are different kinds of vehicles, heavy-duty trucks, school shuttle transit, locomotive, ferries and tugs, forklifts, and airport support. And those projects would be to repower or replace with new diesel, alternate fuel, or all-electric options. Then one of the eligible categories is marine shore power systems. This is to provide powers to the ships when they're docked in port. I mentioned 15% can go to charging stations at rest areas or other place along the interstates, for example. And then there's a diesel emission reduction option as well. So we did issue a request for proposal for the 15% EV charging station network last October. That is $14 million of the $93 million. The funds can be used to pay for up to 80% of the equipment installation. And we are processing or have received some proposals in the process of going through those at this point. So next steps, approval of us as a beneficiary is expected in the next few weeks. That would be by the trustee. Shortly after that, we hope to execute the contract for the 15% to $14 million for the vehicle charging stations. We need to finalize the mitigation plan. That will be done in conjunction with the Secretary's office. Submitted to the trustee, as I mentioned, that has to be submitted in advance of any request for funds, and then develop a competitive process for distributing the trust funds to other categories of those 10 that I mentioned. So that's what some of them, I'd be happy to take any questions that you have.
David's comment first, as we go through session, when we get closest end of session, if you see something that you think that that as far as this program that you think we need to know, please make arrangements to come back and talk to us.
Of course, so, I certainly will.
Sure. Do we have any questions? All right. Seeing none, thank you, sir. Thank you for all your service. Okay, so we're getting close to the end. So let me ask you the subcommittee schedules. I emailed the membership on the subcommittees. I sent that to Barbara, but Barbara Teague had a little accident, and so I just want to make sure that did y'all get that? Yes. Okay. Seeing yes. All right, so what we're going to the committee schedule, subcommittee schedule will be, is that on Monday, the committee number, the subcommittee number one will meet, and that's Delegate Knight, and that will be in 400B conference room over to Pocahontas. Two is is Wednesday afternoon. That's Delegate Edmonds, and that is in 300A conference over in Pocahontas. And then subcommittee three is Delegate Wilt, and that will probably meet, check your time and listing to make sure, but we're probably gonna let them meet before full on Wednesday. And so they will meet about, if he gets up at only at 6 o'clock, so I don't see a lot of folks interested in that. So maybe about 7:30. So we'll look at, if you're on that subcommittee three, please look at that. And they're meeting today, immediately after this. After this. So any questions or thoughts before we adjourn? Seeing none, we stand adjourned. All right, and again, subcommittee three will meet in just a few minutes.
How are you?
How are we now?
Look forward to working with you.
Yeah. Come on down.
Are you guys care? Or do you get involved in issues involving how libraries operate? There's going to be a bill that's going to drop today or tomorrow to start the process of perhaps getting all of the libraries into uniform building code for the rules and all.
If you get a chance, though, say something.
I'll go over there. All right.